My castaway this week is Emma Thompson. A study in overachievement, she is a world-class writer and actress who appears to have pulled off that rare trick of being both a star and one of us. Despite both her parents and her sister being in the business, theirs was not an actory home. We didn't perform at dinner, she says. We just talked. It was a normal family in that sense. And these days, oh, she famously keeps her brace of Oscars in the downstairs loo, still lives across the road from her mum, and holidays in a wee cottage in Scotland, where she and her husband spend a third of the year digging in like a pair of old potatoes, she says, whilst she basically grows a beard. Emma Thompson, it is... basically grows a beard. It's very unusual to hear any woman admit to that, but certainly somebody who is a beauty and an actress and somebody who trades to a large extent on the way that they look on screen. How much do you try not to be preoccupied by how you look?
I try hard not to be. I do. And indeed, I don't think I am considered a beauty in that sense. I've always thought of myself as a character actress. Mm. So I'm, in a sense, I've got much less to lose.
The one of us thing, certainly the press and even some normal people in the public are suspicious of that because they think that somebody who is as accomplished and as creative and is able to do all the things that the rest of us can't do can't be one of us, really.
I think that I encountered the possibility earlier on, you know, when all the Oscar hoo-ha was happening, of living in another way. Shall we say, you know, people would say, well, why don't you come out to Los Angeles and have your own company and things like that? And I thought, but then who would I know? Where would all my friends be? I have this habit of continuity, and I love continuity and the continuum of life. Knowing people for a long, long, long time gives me great pleasure. And if you do that, of course, you haven't got any chance of changing because they'll be the first ones to turn around and say to you, what do you think you're doing? You're being an arse. You're allowed to say arse on desert island
you
discs.
You are, yes.
Oh, my God, the times have changed. I think it was John Ruskin said, he was talking about capitalism, and he said, you know, the acquisition of each new thing just engenders a new form of weariness. And I thought it's the most brilliant way of describing stuff, the stuff that we accrete during our lifetimes. Greg and I certainly have got to the point where we say, can we get rid of this? Yes, come on, let's chuck it. It's like you're going along in your boat and you just want to make it lighter so
yes.
You can travel faster and you can go with the wind a wee bit more. I remember going into Barbara Streisand's house once and she's got about 15 homes and her rooms, each room was done in a different style. Like there was a Japanese lacquered style and there was a Victorian bedroom. I mean, we feel guilty about inhabiting two houses, one in London and one in Scotland, but we do live in them. We really do live in them.
Let's have some music. Tell me about the first track that you've chosen for your island today.
Well, it's a piece called Karasik, which is the name of our house in Scotland, which was bought for about 3 and 6 by my parents when I was 15 years old. And it's surrounded by a river and hills, and you know, I grew up there and now my daughter and son are growing up there. And this piece of music was composed by the Scottish film composer Patrick Doyle, who I've known since I was 23.
He's a tiny wee creature that talks very, very fast. It's very, very funny and completely mad.
And had written music for loads of films that I've been in. He wrote for Ken's movies, for Much Ado, for Henry V, and then for Sense and Sensibility and Annie McPhee. And when I turned 50, he wrote this piece of music, which is about the land surrounding our house, inspired by him walking along a little walk that Greg had built for my mum so that my mum can always walk through the land so it's safe for her to walk because it's, you know, it's rocky and all of that, and which we called laughingly the P. Law Memorial Walk, which is very much alive, my mother, and probably listening as we speak. So, hello, Mum. Don't slip on an Argos catalogue or anything now. And he wrote this and presented it to me as we were roasting a large pig on my 50th birthday last year.
Thank you.
The Hungarian Studio Orchestra and Karasik, composed and conducted by Patrick Doyle. So, Emma Thompson, 50 then. You were 50 last year. Mm. The roasted pig was for that. I read you were going to give yourself a year off. What happened to that then?
Well, I am, but I'm going to do it next year. It took me a while to sort of slow everything down. So next year the plan is to take a sort of sabbatical, really, of pretty much the whole year, but certainly the 6 months between February and August.
So the Scottish thing, tell me more about it. How and when did it begin? I mean, very early on.
Absolutely. It began when I was 3 months old. My mum and dad, my mum's Glaswegian, and we were staying in a little boarding house in Strone on the shores of Loch Long. I mean, obviously, I can't remember this, but Mum tells me the story. And we got to a beach where they found this little cottage. It's built in 1720, this exquisite little pearl of a cottage. And there was a for sale sign, and Mum said, oh, you know, wouldn't it be like... They had no money at all. I mean, literally to the extent that Dad had to get help from Equity, because he was only 300 quid a year, and it just couldn't do us, you know. I was a mistake, incidentally, because they didn't think they had enough money to start a family.
When did they tell you? I always wonder about people who find out they're a mistake. When did they tell you you were a mistake? I hope they waited until you were sort of old enough.
It was less hurtful than what they said about my first performance in the ballet, when I came out as a snowflake at the end of the line, and they both started to laugh, because at the end of this line of lovely teeny wee gorgeous delicate things, there was this great queen mother of a snowflake who was bossing everyone around. And I said, you mean you laughed? They told me that when I was 19, and I remember feeling quite hurt. Anyway, my dad just rang my mum's family and said, can I borrow 300 quid, which is what it cost.
And what are your memories of those very early years of the cottage on the loch?
Just sheer bliss, because we lived in a wee flat in London which had no garden. And I can literally remember having dreams about Scotland and dreaming that I would be there and then waking up in London and being sad. For me, as a child, Scotland was everything. Everything. It was like a paradise to me.
Tell us what we're going to hear next.
Well, this is my dad, Eric, who wrote The Magic Roundabout and was very much known for that. And by the time he was my age, he'd had a terrible stroke and couldn't speak anymore. And I would, at 18 and 19, and my sister, we would help him to learn how to speak again, literally with cards. I am, he is you. And it was very humiliating for this working class man who'd absolutely taught himself everything about language and who was passionate about the spoken word and spoke very well and with a beautiful voice. To have all that taken away from him at the age of 48 was really tough. And losing him when he was 52 tore us to pieces. So Dad's always been very close, very important part of our lives, and this is him talking and singing in his capacity as the Magic Roundabout Man.
Oh, I'll go and see Florence. She's painfully well adjusted. Oh. Florence was at home and singing a song which went something like this. Florence, it's a lovely morning. Florence, shall you work this morning? Florence, if you don't this morning, you will never do it, dear. Florence, you would rather wander. Florence, it's a living wonder that your house is not now under a great big cloud of dust, dust, dust. Clean it up, you must, must, must. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who's the fairest one of all? Not that you should care at all. Being fair's not worth a jot. Be content with what you've got. What you've got is quite a lot. Florence, it's a lovely morning.
That was your father, Eric Thompson, singing Florence, It's a Lovely Morning from the film version of The Magic Roundabout, Dougal and the Blue Cat. And that was recorded, obviously, before his illness and before his speech was taken from him. So an important thing to have him in full sail.
And that beautiful timbre to his voice. And he directed two plays before he died, one of which I crewed on at the Royal Exchange in Manchester. And then he just had a huge pulmonary embolism one morning when I was up in Manchester making sketch shows with Stephen and Hugh, and died. And actually Hugh Laurie read a Magic Roundabout story at his funeral, which was so nice.
Was he quite a sort of sharp, acerbic character? He wasn't.
He could be.
Right.
He was funny, and very witty people are often cruel as well. And he knew that, but very funny too.
And you said, I mean, your mother, of course, Phyllida Law, the actress, you said that it wasn't an actory, lovey household. I mean, did you just sort of find performing by yourself, aside from obviously the incident of being the snowflake that didn't quite come off? Did you?
Yes, I think I did. It was all very accidental because I wasn't going to be an actress. Didn't occur to me really. I mean, both my mum and I loved, the thing we loved best was to make my father laugh because he didn't laugh easily. And when he laughed, it was such a pleasure. And it's the same with Stephen and Hugh. If I can make Stephen and Hugh laugh now, I feel thrilled.
And you referred to Hugh Laurie and Stephen Fry, who were with you at university and in the Footlights at the same time. How did you migrate then from comedy into proper acting and performing?
Because Robbie Coltrane was in Alfresco with us, and they were casting Tutti Frutti, and they said, we need a girl to play Kettles. And Robbie said, you know, you should see Em.
Let's have some more music. Tell me about your third disc. What are we going to hear?
Oh, well, this is the point at which I have to say to Greg, my husband, to switch off the radio because he hates this so much. He's heard it so many times. It's Benjamin Britten's Ceremony of Carols. This is Christmas, really, and I'm not religious at all. Yet this piece of music, it speaks to me about my childhood and the time before my father was ill. And Christmas time was the best.
Thank you.
the opening of Benjamin Britten's A Ceremony of Carols, sung by the choir of King's College, Cambridge, led by Sir David Wilcox. And Greg, your husband, can turn the radio safely back on now, Emma Thompson. You're the only person ever to have won an Oscar for screenwriting and also have won an Oscar for acting. The only person. Does that mean that the industry in Hollywood is more scared of you than they would be a normal actress, if you like? Because you get it, you know the gig, and you are in control, and you're not dependent upon other people to deliver the scripts.
I don't know. They're very welcoming.
Right.
They're very keen on me to write, because, of course, good writing is hard to come by, and treat me well as a writer. And it's nice not to just be on the end of a phone waiting. So I'm quite lucky, I think.
It seems like quite a sort of seamless journey that you made from being a student to then being, I mean, you won a BAFTA for Tutti Frutti, didn't you? Yes. To being this terrifically successful, bright young thing. You even had an agent at Cambridge. I mean, you were spotted and it was...
Yes. That's right. Footlights was one of those hunting grounds. And yeah. We did all of us get an agent when I was about 19, I think. And he, Richard Armitage, was very good because he was the one who always said to me, you've got to do your own thing, you've got to do your own thing. He said, you wanted to write that comedy series, you've got that opportunity, you must do that. And I wrote a comedy series that was torn to shreds.
I'm glad you bring that up, because it almost seemed a point at which the press delighted in saying, ah, yes, you think you're good, do you? Well, we'll tear a strip right off you. I mean, it was very poorly received and a lot of the critics really laid into it.
Yeah, in a very, very personal way,
yes,
as well. It was like a personal attack. You can't do this, you shouldn't be doing this, you should never have been given the money, you are awful, awful, awful. It was real hatred from a lot of journalists, a lot.
And did you think about chucking it in? Did you think, oh.
No, I just thought, well, maybe I should act. Was there, you see, because I think that was part of the problem, was I'd won the BAFTA for Tutti Frutti and Fortunes of War. It was for both of those things. So I had been recognised, if you like, for serious acting, and now I dared to try my hand at comedy, which is what I'd always intended to do. Yet, it's the reason I got to write Sense and Sensibility, because Lindsay Duran watched this show, which was put out in America at about 3 o'clock in the morning, you know, and she happened to see it and said, I like that sketch. I think I'm going to ask this woman to try, because she seems to be able to write in a vernacular that could be Austinian, but she's also funny. And that's why I got that job.
Let's have some music then. What's next?
Oh, now, this is Inti-Illimani. In 1973, when the coup happened in Chile, Victor Jara, who was a Chilean freedom songwriter, was murdered. And Inti-Illimani were all musicians who all knew Victor Jara and were exiled from Chile for 15 years and went all around the world playing their charangas and the Chilean instruments, but also learning instruments from other parts of the world and sitting there listening to these voices. And the thrang of these guitars just fills you with courage.
Inti-Illimani and Candidos. You're never afraid to step out of the box of being the actress and the writer. You put yourself on the line a lot for causes that you believe in, and it attracts a lot of derision. Do you mind the derision?
No, not at all. Because there's a voice there that I can use. If I use it properly, then it doesn't matter what anybody says. I think if you're derided because you're speaking in an area that you don't fully understand, then it probably would hurt, because you would know fine well that you've been speaking somehow out of turn.
I want to talk to you about a period in your life between 1991 and 96, when, by my calculation, you starred in 7 films, you were nominated for 5 Oscars, of which you won 2, and you were also divorced. How on earth did you stay sane in that period?
I don't think I did stay sane, actually. It was tough. I think I probably should have sought professional help long before I actually did. Yeah. For all sorts of reasons. Yes, divorce, ghastly, painful business, but also fame, in some ways ghastly, painful business as well. You become slightly more public property in a way that's not necessarily always comfortable.
When you fell off the edge, where did you go? I mean, was it a proper, full-on, can't answer the phone, can't change my clothes, can't see my friends? What happened?
Well, I think my first bout of that was when I was doing Me and My Girl, funnily enough, when I really didn't change my clothes and couldn't answer the phone and but went into the theatre every night and was cheerful and sang The Lambeth Walk. Oh. But I think that was my first bout with an actual clinical depression. And that's very much the theatre. When my dad died, my mum was in a farce and went on stage. You know, the day he died, she was on stage playing in a farce. So that's what actors do. And then, in a sense, I suppose work did save me. And then Greg saved me, because he picked up the pieces and put them back together again, you know, after Sense and Sensibility.
And is it the case that can I use the word a witch? I don't know, a soothsayer. Somebody said to Greg Wise, now your husband of a good many years, that he was going to meet the woman that he would, his future wife, the woman he would marry on the set of Sense and Sensibility.
And of course I was married, so he thought it was Winslet and courted her assiduously. I remember him taking her to Glastonbury, which she hated because it was all hippie-ish, and Greg's quite hippie-ish, you know. And he kept on thinking, this just isn't working. I think she's just got to be wrong. It was a friend of his who's quite sort of witchy.
And it turned out to be me.
And you were still married, as you say. Did you know you soon would not be married?
Well, I was very not married, actually, pretty much by then. It was all in flames and had been for a while.
And was that anything to do with the amount of work that you and Kenneth Branagh had done together? I mean, you did a lot of very well-received work together.
No, I think we enjoyed that time. I mean, I think at the end of Much Ado, I think that was... I mean, I loved that time. I think Ken found it very difficult, but I loved it. And then it started to fracture.
And so writing Sense and Sensibility, writing about the importance of love and the difficulties of love and the complexities of the most intimate of human relations, was that too easy probably to say it was cathartic? Was it useful?
I think so, very much so. I can remember, actually... I can remember the only thing I could do was write. In the not being able to get dressed, Ken had an old black cashmere dressing gown I'd given him one Christmas in the bathroom, and he was gone. He wasn't living at home. And I used to just put it on and crawl from the bedroom to the computer and just sit and write. And then I was all right because I was not present. And Sense and Sensibility really saved me from, I think, going under in a very nasty way.
Five.
Okay, this is Tom Waits, and it's a song called Hold On, and this is for Gaia, this is giving birth. I loved being pregnant. I was so happy. I was just happier than I'd ever been, and I loved getting bigger and feeling her sloshing around and doing somersaults, and so it was just the best thing. And then giving birth, to fling your head back and let out this kind of leonine roar, and this child to come shooting out of your body in a great pile of stuff and blood, and the smell and the experience of it was beyond anything I could have imagined.
They hung a sign up in our town. If you live it up, you won't live it down. So she left Monte Rio's son, just like a bullet leaves a gun. the charcoal eyes and Monroe hips. She wouldn't took that California trip. Oh, the moon was gold and her hair like wind. Said, don't look back, just come on, Jim. Oh, you got to hold on, hold on. You got to hold on, take my hand. Standing right here, you got to hold on. Dime store watch and a ring made from a spoon. Everyone's looking for someone to blame. And you share my bed, you share my name.
That was Tom Waits and Hold On. Can we talk then about the dastardly Mr. Willoughby, who turned out not to be so dastardly after all?
Yeah.
Your husband now, Greg Wise, who you met, as you say, on Sense and Sensibility.
Yeah.
I don't know if it's indelicate, but can we talk about just how handsome he is?
No, it's not indelicate. He is really beautiful. And waking up and seeing that person every day is, I mean, I can't deny it. It's a great aesthetic pleasure. So, yeah, it's just great, actually.
And it is often the case that people who are physically perfect don't feel that they have to develop much of a character. I suppose you're going to tell me now he's got a great personality as well.
No. No. No personality at all. Yes, he's very eccentric because he doesn't think of himself as beautiful. His sense of himself, his virility, his manliness is contained in other areas. It's to do with his relationship with wood and the countryside in Scotland and his daughter and the practical matters of life. And it's changed all our lives in Scotland by introducing a Finnish sauna to the land.
You'd spoken to journalists before about wanting to be a parent, and then you'd spoken about the fact that you had miscarried. There is nothing more private than that. And yet you had put it out there.
Yes, I don't mind that.
Do you not?
Not really, no. I mean, I think that in relation to miscarriage and IVF and all of those subjects, I think it's very helpful for people like me to talk about that, because an awful lot of women go through that and they think that it's only them, and it's only them that feel awful about, you know, having had difficulties and failing to produce children and feeling that as a terrible failure, which is so wrong. I feel close to other people. I feel like them. I think, again, it's part of the activist in me that says, yes, it's fine to talk about that because it's a shared problem somehow.
Thank you.
What's next?
Actually, this is Greg's song. This is something that he introduced me to that I loved immediately and continue to love 15 years later. I can't believe it's 15 years. Oh, my gosh. And this is Us Three, and it's the Cantaloop Fantasia, and it's groovy, groovy, jazzy, funky.
You've referred to your two children, mm. and we know about Gaia and we know about the IVF.
Mm.
Tell me about Tindy, because that is a very different story.
Yes. Well, I support an organisation called the Refugee Council, who offer help to refugees in this country. And in fact, when Tindy arrived in this country, he spent the first two nights sleeping rough in Trafalgar Square, which is inconceivable. So I'm like, this little 16-year-old, which he was at the time, having come from a truly appalling story, his very difficult, which I won't go into because I think that's his story to tell, not mine. But I met him at a Christmas party that we'd give once a year. And this relationship started to develop, not just with me, but with Greg, with Gaia, who was two at the time, my mum. And he became, as it were, an organic sense, part of our family within that year. And then it continued the story because the Home Office, in all its wisdom, not, after 5 years, decided to challenge his leave to remain. So we had to go to court. So you consider that in relation to someone who has had a terribly difficult time anyway and has lost his family, the sense of being suspected of something is very strong. And we were very well served by an extraordinary judge, Judge Blandy, who we all love.
And from arriving and sleeping on the streets of London at 16, I understand precisely what you say about respecting his privacy and that this is his story, but just to understand the journey that he has made, he is still studying or he's finished studying?
He decided to do an MA in human rights law, which he's doing now this year at SOAS, at the School of Oriental and African Studies. And this is a boy who arrived with really no English at all, and at 23 is about to get his MA in human rights law. He's extraordinary.
Is he Gaia's brother?
Yes, absolutely.
Right.
Absolutely. Gaia's so thrilled about it, because of course she was two when he turned up. She's 10 now. He's been a part of her life forever, and they have a very brotherly, sisterly relationship as well, and it's fantastic to see. We're very, very lucky, very lucky. Sometimes I think as well, you know, if I had had, if my other IVFs had worked and I'd had more children, perhaps there wouldn't have been room for this young man who has changed our lives so much and who we all love so much.
Thank you. Let's have disc number 7 now. Tell me what it is, Emma.
Well, this is my brother-in-law, Richard Lumsden, who is a musician, amongst other things. He's also a wonderful actor. I was in San Francisco doing Junior with Arnold Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito and having a fun time.
What's Arnold Schwarzenegger like?
Well, he's orange, rather oldie-worldy, Prussian. So you almost expected him to click his heels. And very humble about the fact that he wasn't an actor. You know, I'm not an actor. You must tell me what to do. I am in your hands. Lots of loud laughing. So there I was in San Francisco with Arnold. And my sister sent me this tape and said, I've met this man and I think he's something special to me. So here's his music. And I loved his music. I played this tape the whole time at a time when I was actually very unhappy because it was, you know, I was 35 and it was absolute curtains for my marriage with Ken and I was not in a good state. And this tape that Soph sent was incredibly helpful to me. So this song is about the fact that not everything you do will succeed and that's okay.
Some of your planes will come down. Some of your rain will fall. Some of your fires won't burn. Some of your lovers won't call. And when you're on the floor, you come back for more. You see the light shining through the holes in your roof.
That was your brother-in-law, Richard Lumsden, and Some of Your Planes. You've spoken about a life that seems very rich and very together, especially when you speak about your time with all of your extended family up in Scotland. And you're doing work that is well appreciated and highly regarded. And I'm going to send you to an island. How on earth are you going to cope on the island without any of that?
Well, it's not going to be easy, but I think that I will tell stories. I will probably create a mythology quite quickly and on purpose and start to see if I can't tame a seagull or something. I'll have to make relationships with the island, within the island, and then within those relationships tell stories. I think that's how I'll survive it. Is by creating stories.
I thought maybe it was too obvious a question to ask, but I'm wondering of those Academy Awards, which one meant the most to you? I mean, is it the telling of stories and the language that is more important than the acting?
Yes, I think it is, because it's harder. I'm not saying that acting isn't hard. It depends. I find it joyous and life-giving and fun, even if it's traumatic. An escape from myself, which I'm ashamed to say I enjoy very much.
What are you escaping?
Oh, you know, me. The voices in my head, the constant, you must do better.
Yes.
You must try harder. Plus you're too fat and you're not very, you know, really very good mother. And that punitive conscience is part of my psychiatric problem. Not to put too fine a point on it, listeners.
And as a loved daughter, where did that come from? Where did the not good enough come from? Where's that voice originating?
I don't know. I mean, I think that Mum and Dad both came from the post-war semi-puritanical upbringings. I mean, my mum's Scottish, so the Presbyterian thing is strong within us. I think it was a creation of my own making and was always there. Something to do with justice, and I couldn't cope with suffering of any kind. I had to put it right somehow. And of course, that's very arrogant to think that you can alleviate the world's suffering. You can't. And so one of the most important things for me to learn over this
life that I've had is that I can't save the world. I can do what I can do, and that has to be enough. In the same way as clever people say, you're a good enough mother, that has to be enough. It's just the way I am. It's never quite enough.
Your final piece of music then, Emma Thompson, is what?
Well, oddly appropriate, really. This is Joe Cocker, and it's him singing at Woodstock with a little help from my friends, which is quite a sort of upbeat number with the Beatles, but with Joe Cocker becomes this great cry of anguish. And I thought that would be a very good thing to have on the island, because at some point you're going to feel deep anguish, and this will express it, I think, very well, and I might be able to join in. So that's for the dark times.
Would you believe in a love at first sight?
I'm certain it happens all the time. You know it does.
What?
I don't see nothing, but it's just a lie. Don't you know I gotta live? I gotta live to know my friend. I'm gonna stay the way I feel now.
Joe Cocker, and with a little help from my friends. So, Emma, we come to the moment then where I will give you the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare.
Lovely.
And another book you're choosing.
Yes. Well, this was hard, as you can imagine.
Yes.
But I finally plumped for Homer's Odyssey. I'm now talking about the mythology of the island. And I thought, well, Homer will help, of course, because he wrote some of the greatest myths ever. And I love the Greek myths. I've always loved them. I loved them when I was a little girl. So I thought, well, the Odyssey is good because, as well, it's about an exile.
And I could learn Greek. Because I'd have both the English and the Greek.
It's yours. And a luxury as well.
I know that the thing I would miss most is cooking. So I want a saucepan. I've got it at home. I would bring it with me. You don't have to buy it for me. It's a round, heavy-bottomed, cast-iron saucepan with a removable handle.
Cunning.
So you see, because otherwise the handle gets too hot and you can't stir anything or take it off the heat. And because there's nothing on the island you can cook in, you see. So if I have a pot, then one of the first things I can do is go around testing veg and seeing if there's anything herbal I can make something different with and start creating an island cuisine.
The special cooking pot is yours. And if you had to choose just one to save, one of these 8 discs, which one would you choose to save?
I'd save Karasik, Pat's music, because it's so personal. I'd find that very inspiring.
Emma Thompson, thank you very much for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
You're welcome.